And from the already high sales of his autobiography, More or Less, it doesn't seem as if I need to mention your book either. But I tell you what I do want to know. Did you write that book because you wanted to write about yourself or because somebody said, go on, you'll sell a lot of copies?
That's a good question. I didn't really want to write it at all, Mavis, because I feel that when you write an autobiography, it must be without malice. You mustn't hurt anybody or try not to hurt anybody. And yet you must be truthful. And it's very difficult to balance the two. Mm-hmm. You'll always hurt somebody and you'll always make somebody very happy. I didn't want to do it. A lot of my friends tapped me on the back in the Garrick Club and said, come on, Kenny, it's about time you wrote it now. And so I went ahead and did it. I didn't want to, though.
100,000 copies sold already, so I'm told.
They don't tell me anything, but apparently the Daily Mail says so.
But what does that mean, that you feel quite sort of glad that people like you? Because that must be what it means.
Yes, it is. It is a lovely sort of feeling.
Yes.
When people come up to you in the street and just don't ask for your autograph, but they say, thank you for all the pleasure you've given us in your lifetime, Mr. Moore. And that is rather gratifying.
Did you discover anything else about yourself when you were writing that autobiography? Something new about yourself? No.
The ability to absorb dramatic happenings, I think. Mm. I was rather ostracized when I left my wife for Angela, as you well know.
But your second wife?
My second wife, yes.
And then for Angela, a younger woman, which is part of what that story is all
about. The last
20
years of my life have been rather dramatic. I learned how to absorb those moments.
You brought that up yourself, because in your book you obviously were terribly hurt by the way it's looked as if you were thrown aside.
Well, I wasn't so much hurt, Mavis. I was amazed. Old friends that I'd been literally so close to, it wasn't true, just cutting me in the street.
Why? Why did they do it?
Well, I worked it out in the end. I mean, in hindsight, it's always easier, isn't it? I think it was the wives who were responsible, because they were all middle-aged, all my friends, as I was. And the wives are frightened that their husbands might do the same things I did.
Well, run off with a younger woman.
Exactly. So I'd rather blame them.
You've got, though, quite a sort of fearless statement about ladies in your book. Can I quote you?
Certainly.
Faithfulness in marriage, for a man at least, is like a handmade silk shirt. It can wear thin. I mean, that doesn't
I think I was trying to be a bit too clever there. Because I don't believe that faithlessness in marriage doesn't really work.
But why did you say that, I wonder? You did say it
I'm just carried away a bit, I suppose.
Were you? But you are a bit of a
bold
flirt.
Bold thing to say.
You are
a terrible flirt. I always have been all my life. But I love women. I adore them. But marriage must really rely on faithfulness.
You also thought that love was only real when it came like that, and that love could not grow, you said.
Yes, I believe that.
Are you talking about falling in love? Because I don't agree with you. I think you can fall in love like that, but you can love quite a long time
well,
after.
Well, there's a great difference between love and falling in love, isn't there? But as for falling in love, I'm sure that's true. Mm. As for loving a person, the more you're with them, the more they grow on you, as it were. And it's nothing to do with sex, nothing to do with sex at all. Love is a very deep thing which comes through the years. Understanding, happiness, togetherness, something that only works in one certain way.
Mm-hmm. Once upon a time there was a little boy. You had a nanny and
boy,
a butler.
Yes.
And
a very generous father. And a sailor suit.
Right. That's you, isn't it? Because it sounded just like a fairy story, your little childhood bit.
Well, it was always a terrible disappointment because my father, who was perhaps one of the most generous men that ever lived, I mean, I hope if it's brushed off on me. He couldn't bear children, really. And he wanted us to get out of the way, you know. He wanted the house to his wife. And we were sent to a boarding school at the age of 6 in a sailor suit. And we were told we were going to Fairyland by our nanny. And instead of Fairyland, of course, we had fishtail gas lamps, yellow margarine, and all those horrible things. I wet my bed every night for years. I was very miserable, very unhappy.
But did you also feel cheated that if your mother and father said to you, you're going to Fairyland, you didn't put this in your book, you know, did you?
No, not all of it. They cut a lot out. Mm. One always writes too much and they cut things out.
Yes.
All my lovely lavatory stories, they cut all those out.
Your what, darling?
Lavatory stories.
I thought you said that. Do you mean...
Oh, no, I mustn't tell you.
No, quite. That's the chaps intruding again, you see. But tell me this. You know, when you said your father and mother wanted to get rid of you out of the house, was that your father or your mother? Because your mother...
Father.
Yes.
My mother was a delightful, pretty Welsh lady with not a brain in her head, but a lovely person. My father ruled the roost.
Hmm. You adored him, though, even though he didn't like you.
I loved him, darling, because he was such a wonderful man. He had a marvellous personality. He got through 2 fortunes. He gave all his money away. If you asked him for a fiver, he'd say, you can't manage on that, have a tenner. And he was a wonderful person, but completely irresponsible. He was always inventing things which never went right.
Such as what?
Well, such as he invented a liqueur called Vespatrio. I don't know how one can invent a cure in England. It's possible, but he did. He got a bit of Benedictine, a bit of brandy, mixed them all together and said, now we've got a new liqueur. Which, of course, that came to... He spent a fortune on getting the labels printed and the bottles cleaned and heaven knows what. He invented a liquid which was supposed to make everything waterproof, called Rumac. It did make everything waterproof, but they fell to pieces in 2 weeks.
Rotted, you mean?
Rotted away. And the whole house stank for months afterwards. It was awful. He invented the carburetor, which really did work, which made you go 30 miles to the gallon instead of 15 miles to the gallon. But, of course, the petroleum companies soon sat on that. He was offered a partnership by Lord Nuffield, believe it or not, when Lord Nuffield was not Lord Nuffield, just William Morris. He came to the house and offered my father a partnership. And my mother said, I don't like him very much, do you? And he turned him down.
Your father, he died when you were quite young, didn't he?
45.
Yeah. So he was 45 when he died, yes. Well, how old were you?
18, yeah. 19.
So do you know what he wanted you to become?
He hadn't a clue, poor man. He had so many worries before his death. All his money had run out. He was an ill man, a sick man. He couldn't think of me very much. Or my sister.
What were you thinking about then at 18, as you wanted to be?
Oh, I tell you. When he died, that was that. I couldn't be an engineer because mathematics was not my strong subject. I got 2.5% in school certificate out of sympathy. I wanted to go to Canada and become a fur trapper. I wanted to shoot polar bears and catch seals and heaven knows what else. And my grandmother gave me £100. And I took a friend of mine to Canada with me. And unfortunately, he said, I'll only come with you on one condition, that my girlfriend comes with us. I fell hopelessly in love with a girlfriend. We got as far as Quebec. We were taken off by the immigration launch. We were put into the immigration prison and just sent home again. That's all. We tried to get into Canada with $24 and a lot of hope.
You didn't want to be an actor much, did you? For ages and ages.
No, didn't want to be. Van Damme, who owned the Windmill Theatre, told me he would give me a job because he knew my father well, providing I never became an actor. He said, they're bloody awful people, actors. I don't like them at all. But then I went on for little bits and pieces, sketches and things like that, and the bug bit me.
You said, though, that you thought that actors should not mix with anybody but actors.
It's not quite true, but...
You did say that?
Yes, I know, but it's not...
What do you mean, then? What did you mean, even if you didn't quite mean that?
Well, what I mean is that it takes an actor to have another actor's sense of humour. The laity, as I may call them, the non-acting profession, they're not really with us. We have our own peculiar brand of humour, which only goes when we're together, I'm sure.